And then I got a call from Charlie Rich's son, Alan Rich. He was living in Memphis. He had just put out a record on Epic. And somehow or another, he got my name. And so I moved to Memphis for about a year and a half and played with Alan until his thing didn't really pan out. And I started playing with Charlie Rich for a while. You know, it was natural. And I think he felt bad about me not having a gig, so I think he talked his dad into hiring me. But anyway, that was fun. Charlie was great. That was really, really fun. Anyway, I got tired of Memphis and moved back to Austin. Was knocking around down there for a while, and then. But at that time, Austin kind of had a glass ceiling. You couldn't make any money. You could play yourself to death in bars and stuff, but you couldn't really make any money. So I had some friends up here who were playing in a house band at a club here called Fanny's. Now, keep in mind, all the time, I'd started to do like custom records and stuff like that, but I mean, neither place in Memphis nor Austin really had an industry to speak of. So it's one of those things, you know, do a record in a day or two and get paid horrible wages, no union stuff or anything like that. So I'm visiting my friends that are playing in the house band at Fanny's, and I meet Jim Cotton. I re-meet Jim Cotton. Jim Cotton was an engineer that I met in Memphis, and he was the head engineer at a place called Sound Lab. Well, through him, I met Billy Earl McClellan, who had a deal in Elektra. He was about to cut his first record. So anyway, we started playing with him, and he was writing for Tree. So then I got introduced to, you know, the guys at Tree Publishing. And writers at Tree then were, I mean, it was like the Mount Rushmore of writers, you know, Curl Putnam and Hank Cochran. And anyway, really great writers. And so I got in with the crew over there, and we were all youngsters, but Eddie Bayers was playing drums, and Paul Worley was playing guitar, and Dennis Burnside. So we, you know, one thing led to another, and pretty soon I was doing a lot of demos at Tree. And anyway, I said, you know, this is a pretty good idea. So, I mean, I hadn't moved up here permanently, but I decided, it's like, okay. I'd never even dreamed that I would live in Nashville. It wasn't on my radar at all, but, you know, here I am, you know. Geez, I don't know, that was in 77, so that's, you know, almost 40 years later, right? To backtrack a little bit, now, you know, growing up where I did and learning music as I did, because I'm all self-taught, I never went to school to do all that kind of stuff, but you kind of have to play for your life, you know, I mean, you get in a situation, I mean, you have to be able to play a wide variety of music, at least you did then, you know, to make a living. So that, you know, little did I know, was informing me for what I would need later on in life, as is so often the case, you know. You just do what's in front of you, do what you gotta do, and you're accumulating experience and knowledge and stylistic variations and stuff like that. And plus, I was interested in a lot of music. I mean, I went through a lot of phases, you know. I got fusion ears disease for a while, you know.
Yeah, we all get that.
Yeah, I know.
At some point. That's great.